the second question you have to answer in order to see which statistical tests you need to perform on your data is the question, are your data normally distributed or not? It is linked to the first question. So if the data is not normally distributed, it falls into this category, the ranked data, and you have to analyze it using statistical tests that work on ranked data. If the data are normally distributed, then it will fall into this data type, a special data type for normally distributed data. So it's an important question. So normally distributed data, what are they? The easiest way to explain this is by giving an example. So suppose these are my measurements, and I want to make a plot of my measurements. So what am I going to do? I'm going to divide the range of my measurements into small equal parts, and these are called bins. So I take a bin between 100 and 110, I take a bin between 110 and 120, and so on. And in each bin, I'm going to count how many of my measurements fall in that bin. So for instance, I have here in my data five measurements between 100 and 110, and I have 13 measurements between 110 and 120. And in this way, I make this plot, this bar chart. So this is called a histogram. And when the histogram looks like a bell, it means that the data are normally distributed. So normally distributed data have two very nice characteristics. First of all, the data has a peak in the middle. You can see that here, the peak. So that means that the middle bin is the one that has the highest number of measurements. Second characteristic of normally distributed data is the fact that the data are symmetrical. There's an equal number of measurements below the peak as there are above the peak. These two characteristics, the fact that you have a peak in the middle and that the distribution is symmetrical, make that you can do specific statistical tests that will only work on this type of data. So unfortunately, in biology, most of the data are not normally distributed. So what does it mean? It means that when you make a histogram of the data, that it will not look like a symmetrical bell. It can have a bell shape, as you can see here in the first two examples, but it's not a symmetrical bell. It's called a skewed bell. So it means that you do have a peak, but here in this case, there are more values below the peak than that there are above the peak. So this is called a negatively skewed distribution. This is called a positively skewed distribution. And sometimes you don't see a bell shape at all. So in biology, most of the data are positively skewed. You have a lot of low values and then a few high ones. So how can you work with these data? They are not normally distributed. Well, there are two options here. You can either transform the data. What does that mean? It means that you're going to do a mathematical transformation on your measurements. You're going to calculate the log, the square root, or the reciprocal of your measurements. And there's a good chance that these transformed values will be normally distributed. That's one option. You can also just say, well, the data is not normally distributed, so my data falls in this category. It's ranked data. So to analyze the data, I'm not going to work with the data as such, but I'm going to calculate the ranks of my data. What does that mean? It means that you're going to order your measurements from the smallest to the highest. The smallest gets rank 1, the second to smallest gets rank 2, and so on. And instead of doing statistics on the actual measurements, you're going to do statistics on these ranks. So you see that to decide which type of data you have, it's very crucial that you can check if your measurements are normally distributed or not. So how can you check it? Well, you can see that in the flowchart here. So if you have a large data set, more than 30 measurements per group, you can assume that the data are normally distributed. So there's a nice feature of large data sets. They are quite robust against skews. Now, it is still a very good idea to check this assumption by making a histogram of your data. If you don't have a large data set, then it depends on how small it is. If you have more than 6 values, you can check if the data are normally distributed using either the Shapiro-Wilk test or the D'Agostino-Pearson omnibus test. So they are both statistical tests, so they will give you a p-value, and that p-value will indicate whether the data are normally distributed or not. Which test you choose doesn't matter that much, but it is very important to realize that both tests do not work or not reliable when you have very small samples, so 6 or less measurements per group, or when you have very large samples, more than 30 measurements per group. In both cases, the p-value that is generated by these tests is not reliable. So this is why I said, for large data sets, make a histogram. So what to do when you have a very small data set? So 6 or less values per group. Well, in that case, it still depends on how small it is. If you have more than 3 values per group, you can do a residual analysis. What does it mean? It means that you're going to do these statistical tests, but you're not going to do them on the actual data. You're going to do them on the residuals. And I will come back on that. Alternatively, if you don't want to do a residual analysis, you have to choose yourself. So you can say yourself, I assume my data are normally distributed and I'm going to do a test that is specifically for normally distributed data. And that's okay. The only thing that you have to realize is that this test might generate a false positive. It might say that there is a difference between your groups, while in reality there is not. Why? Because these tests are the least stringent of all the statistical tests. So they are the most likely to say that there is a difference between your groups. You can also assume that your data are not normally distributed and do a test for ranked data instead. That's okay, as long as you realize that the test might generate a false negative. It will say that there's nothing going on in your data, while in reality there is a difference between your groups, so you might miss things. So basically, you have to choose here between potentially generating a false positive or generating a false negative. So the best choice here is to go for the residual analysis. If you have very small data sets, so 3 values per group, then you have to assume the data is normally distributed. Why? Well, because the tests that work on ranked data are more stringent. So it will be hard to prove that there is a difference between your groups. And when you don't have a lot of data, that makes it even harder to prove that there is a difference. So when you have very few data, you need a huge difference before a test that works on ranked data will say, there is a difference here between your two groups. They're just too stringent for that. So when you have very small data sets, you assume that the data are normally distributed, but of course you have to take into account that the test might give you a false positive. So always follow that up by a test in the lab that confirms the outcome of the statistical test. So what is this residual analysis? So it's a Shapiro-Willick test and a D'Agostino-Pearson omnibus test, but not done on the original data. No, they are done on the residuals. What are the residuals? In statistics, residuals are the difference between your actual data values and the model, the statistical model. Now, in these examples where we compare groups, what is the model? The model is the mean of each group. So for every group, you calculate the residual by subtracting the mean from the measurements. And then you're going to put all these residuals together and you're going to do the Shapiro-Wilk or the D'Agostino-Pearson omnibus tests on this combined group of all the residuals of all the groups. And that's why it will work on small data sets. So when you do these tests on the original data, you do them on each group separately. And I told you they need at least 7 values to be reliable. So it means you need at least 7 values in each group. In residual analysis, you're going to use these tests on the residuals. And for the residuals, you're going to put all the groups together. So that means that for residuals, you need to have at least 7 measurements in total for all the groups together. What these normality tests will tell you is whether the residuals are normally distributed or not. And if the residuals are normally distributed, there's a big chance that your data are also normally distributed. So if you don't have enough measurements to check normality of the data, just check normality of the residuals. There's a very good relation between the two. So this is what you do on small data sets. When you have large data sets, you make a histogram. You cannot do the Shapiro-Wilk test and the D'Agostino-Pearson omnibus test because they will be too stringent. They will very likely say that the data are not normally distributed, while in fact they are. So for these cases, for these large data sets, assume that they are normally distributed, but make a histogram to check this assumption. If you see a little skew, it's okay. Still assume normal distribution. If you see a very big skew, transform your data, do a log transformation. If you see 2 bell curves, then you know that there are 2 populations in your data and you have to find the factor, the thing that determines these 2 populations. So males and females, or maybe you see a difference between young and old individuals. So that brings me to the question here. So I give you these 2 samples, sample A and sample B. For which of the 2 samples should you do a normality test?